light in dialogue with the colorants transformation process into electrical energy that then goes to a light source, an LED, that then shines on the reproduction with its aesthetic energy that goes to the human brain that creates some energetic sparks between the synaptical entities in the brain. Gives perhaps also some feeling, some emotional energy.
Bart contacted me. He was organizing a course and invited me to speak about this one solar cell technology that I was working with already for quite some time. I think we made a connection very early on, and I was excited about this opportunity to actually work with an artist.
Certainly working perfectly.
This is shaped, the proportionality is related to the shape of the original snowstorm steamboat of Harbour painting by William Turner. What came first is the research that started in, let's say, 2007. It is called the undisclosed poiesis of the photovoltaic effect, which is when I started doing research into the relation between light, energy and bodies. And throughout that work, I encountered, talking about my work in the Midwest of Latvia, a plantation that I was pointed to by the local people who heard about my work, and they said, if you're interested in dark natural colors, we have here an abandoned plantation of a berry that produces very dark juice that might be interesting for your work. So they took me to that plantation, and that was what is called an aronia plantation. So I started to use the dark color of that fruit in experiments and public works as the main agency that converts light into electrical energy in all kinds of experimental devices. One of the public labs that I did with experimental digestible solar cells, in which people were asked to stick out their tongue and test the edible solar cell that they had made following my indications, with the aronia juice as, again, the main edible ingredient. And then at some point, walking at the plantation, as I annually have been doing since 2009, there was this epiphanal moment when I understood that I had to be the one that would connect the relation that the plant has with light and energy and color to a painting of an iconic art master. And then somehow I understood that this human art master should be William Turner. And then this work of his, Snowstorm, that became the painting that we would like to use as a medium to allow to connect aronia, the berry that is an apple, with William Turner, in the sense that the reproduction that we make using the colors of the berry, of its leaves and of its juice, we will use these components to make a reproduction of this original painting of William Turner. And not only it will be inspired by this original, but it will convert light into electrical energy. So we will have a kind of biosolar painting. In the process, there's a lot of steps that require patience, perfection. You have to understand how the machines work. So you have to read a lot of guides. You need to have a good guide. Luckily, a student that works with Janne Halme, he guided me patiently throughout the whole process. You have to develop an intimate relation with machine, with matter. And your body has to adjust, develop new movements, and it's quite a kind of a poetic context, the making of it.
How I took this collaboration in the beginning was that I had a very specific kind of an engineering role in this team. I my team was able to make the solar cell. So it was up to us to make sure that the solar cells work well. With an engineering mind set, the challenge was that print these natural dyes extracted from the plant that Bart is working with. I assume that it's our job to try to reproduce the colors as accurately as possible. An exciting engineering challenge. Can we create the same colors as the original painting has? And our method was this inkjet printing, because it's an accurate way of dosing precise amounts of ink in the painting. Exactly where we want, exactly how much we want, which we had demonstrated in our earlier publications. So we went and tried to do this, but turned out that it's very difficult actually. Suddenly I realized that, hey, it's what we are trying to do is to reproduce a painting. So why don't we just paint the dyes? And we quickly went to the lab, took the same dyes, a paintbrush, and just by hand painted the dye solution on the titanium dioxide film, made the solar cell, and it worked perfectly. This was a moment of kind of a revelation that how stupid it is that we were trying to print a solar cell while we can just paint it as the original artist had done it. That was one of the moments when I realized that I wasn't making science or engineering, I was participating in making art. And that opened up the whole new way of seeing that what we can do together.
So what we wanted to do is to indeed to match the color palette that Turner used to make that snowstorm steamboat of Harbour, etc., long title painting, and so match it with the color palette that the plant generates as a result of its relation with light. We used first the part that I had been already using, which is the colors of the fruits, that to some extent you can play with adjusting the acidity, the pH. But we also started to look at other parts of the plant, predominantly the leaves. And then we found out that the pigments that the leaves produce, they can also be used in the context of solar technology. And that also, if you mix the colors being extracted from the leaves or from the fruits, you can make mixtures with them. And that will not influence the transformational capacities of light into electrical energy. And at some point, we found out that the palettes were still not matching. And then one of our collaborating scientists specialized in synthetic biology said, but we can easily, in a more synthetic way, generate these missing colors. And then I said, yes, but then we lose a bit of connection with the plant. Then I looked into the other living entities that live within the plant, the microorganisms, to see if they would have some color properties that would be beneficial for our color palette. And this is how we found that there is one particular bacteria living together with the plant, which is called by humans Pseudomonas fluorescens. And what made me very happy was that the bacterial species secretes color, and it is a color that we did not yet have in our palette. It's a green, white greenish color. And one particular aspect of this color is that when you shine ultraviolet light on it, it will fluoresce, which provides us with possible other creative pathways, so to speak.
I was very determined to make the electrical connections in the optimal way. And therefore, the end result is looking like this, where the places of the solar cells were not determined by their similarity in electrical performance, the current and voltage, but rather they were just painted by the artist on specific spots, and later on measured what is the current and voltage. And in order to make the optimal connections, the electrical connections need to jump over each other, and these two solar cells need to be borrowed from this column to the larger cells over here, and the other column goes here. But you know, again, a demonstration of an engineering approach for applied in making art, and kind of happy that it looks like art when I try not to do art but engineering.
We learned from the making process of the panel for the tryout, and also from the feedback from the people that came over to experience this setup. The next version we then made for a group exhibition at the university, but that actually felt like a second trial due to the pandemic measures. But still, Janne and fellow scientists have done a lot of measuring of the electric and visual properties. So we are now opening up for ways to share the work with society at large. For me, it was never about the efficiency of these colorants, how long they will live or be active or functional. I was much more interested by the poetic aspects of this technology, because it is so fragile, it is so almost futuristic. It goes, of course, it taps into narratives, speculative narratives of eternal access to electrical energy if these natural colorants would live on. So, I find their fragility for me is an adding. It also obliges me to limit what we are doing. And it's an invitation to go deeper into the connecting with these colorants, and of course the plant and the plant's symbiotic endophytic organisms. Colors also change of the colorants when they are used and exposed to light. So this eternal context of change, of morphing, is kind of for me interesting. So our solar cell panel painting will evolve over time in terms of electrical output, aesthetical output, whereas Turner's work is still considered iconic 200 years after its producing in 1842. All these tensions between aesthetic energy, electric energy, the notion of art and perception over time, I feel that this is an interesting field of tension that might generate in itself transformational energy. This is what I hope, poetic force, so to speak, poetic power.